cooking with science. You know, when did it actually start? When did people start cooking with science? Really seriously. And the answer is, all of you do it all the time. Everyone's been doing it all their lives who cooks. But there was one bit of kit which came into our homes quite a while ago. I can remember when they came into my home, which is called a microwave oven. We've got one here. And it's worth asking the question, how do they work? Anyone know how one works? No one's going to dare put their hand up. If I go into a school, particularly a primary school, and ask kids, do you know how one of these works? Every kid in the class puts their hand up, says, I know it works. It's very easy. You open the door, you put some food in there, you push the button, it cooks it. It's absolutely true. But actually, microwaves heat mostly water. They heat anything that's got what we call hydroxyl bonds in. So I thought we'd actually heat some water up in a microwave. So I put some water in a very careful container, a plastic balloon, and I'm going to tie it up. So there we have a balloon of water, nothing but water. So I squished all the air out of it. And we will, or I will try, and cook it for a while. Bear with me, because I don't know how to use a microwave, so it could be fun. But I think, oh, something's happening. Right, so now, with a bit of luck, the heat will go in there. The microwaves, which are generating a magnetron on the side here, get bounced around inside. And as they get bounced around inside, they heat the water up. And after a little while, the water gets 100 degrees and starts to boil. And oh, look, the balloon blows up because it's now got water vapor inside it. It's amazing. And what always never fails to amaze me how kids love this, a demonstration of something really simple, that when you heat liquid up, it turns to a gas. There you are. Now we've got gas in there. And of course, as it cools back down again, it becomes water again. Isn't that amazing? Now, what strikes me is really, the first time I did this, it was just because I hadn't got anything else with me to put in the microwave, actually. So I stuck that in to prove it happens. But you can do an enormous amount of science with that one simple thing, because you could actually measure the exact amount of water you put in the balloon. You can do that by weighing the balloon before you put the water in, and again after you put the water in, so you know how much there is in there, so you know exactly how much water. And you can measure the volume of the balloon very easily with a camera, by taking two photographs and working it out. It's actually something which takes no time at all in a class if you want to do it in school. And then you can calculate from that something simple, the fact that the expansion factor is about 700 when you turn water into steam and atmospheric pressure. And you can also, by noting the power of the microwave, actually, and the time it takes to heat, you can actually work out specific heat of water and the heat of vaporization of water to steam. Really powerful science experiment. But now, something else has happened. I'm just going to call this balloon right down because I don't have my hat. I think it's a cold water. Right, fine. Now, that balloon now is cold. Okay, fine. But if you notice, it's got some gas in it. I want you to think about where that gas came from for a minute, while we talk a little bit more about how microwaves work. How many of you use microwaves every day? Okay, is there anyone who doesn't use microwaves every day? Put your hand up. Okay, are you really, really sure you don't use microwaves every day? What makes you think you don't, sir? Okay, would you mind seeing if you've got in your pocket a microwave generator? Sorry? Yep, your mobile phone is a microwave generator. Fine. So every one of us has pretty much has got one of these in our pockets right now. So you use our microwaves every day. How do mobile phones work? I mean, why do they work? The microwaves transmit the signals around, and then when they come to the mic for the actual phone themselves, there's an error in the phone. The microwaves hit the aerial, and just like they do for radio or anything else, the microwave radiation generates an electric current in the aerial. So we can, by using anything which will conduct electricity, detect microwaves. I happen to have in my hand here a perfect microwave detector, which you can put inside a microwave and convert the microwaves from electromagnetic radiation to electricity, and then electricity into something we can see, light. It's called a light bulb. A tungsten filament light bulb. So if you put, let's close that again, and okay, I'll give it 29 seconds, that's probably long enough. So now if I put that in there, right, and cook it, what's going to happen? Now obviously, oh, you can't put metals in a microwave, rubbish. Right, now then, I need to stop, clear and start again. So what will happen is, as I switch it on, The microwaves will be round there, the light bulb will go round, and the microwaves will reach the filament, they will turn into electricity in the filament will therefore light. Now, also you'll notice it doesn't stay on everywhere as it goes around. There are places in the microwave where there are very low density of microwaves, so the light bulb goes off. As it goes around, it gets hotter. Of course, the tanks are melted to 3,000 degrees, and then the glass will blow up. Sorry, didn't quite time that right. I forgot to tell you what's going to happen first. It always goes wrong. I'm not used to this. This is a more powerful microwave than used to. But that was meant to happen, by the way. It wasn't an accident. just happened a bit sooner than I meant it to. So this is something, if you try it at home, remember, you've now got glass in your microwave. But the important thing to notice there is that microwaves, as you go around, aren't the same intensity everywhere, which is why people don't generally use microwaves for cooking, because you get uneven cooking, uneven heating in your food, which is not good. Jenny, what do you use microwaves for then? Porridge. Cooking your porridge, okay, fine. Basically, drying your socks. Ah, well, yes, I won't go into that one. One thing that people do use it for a lot is for defrosting stuff. And if you go to any posh restaurant kitchen today, you'll actually find a few of these in the kitchen, I promise you. They're used for all sorts of things, just not cooking. So, defrosting, what do you do with defrosting? You put your food in the microwave and you set it on a lower power. And we need, therefore, to have another detector in there. The first one's broken. So you put on a second detector in the microwave, and I think we'll just clear this one. So, yeah, put that in there. And this time, I'll put it onto a lower power, because of course, you want a lower power. So I think if I do that, and then twiddle this knob, that's on 50% power, it says there. What will happen? Some people would think if you put it on 50% power, that means you'd have half the intensity, so you'd get half the light coming out. No. If you put it on 50% power, it'll be on for 50% of the time and off for 50% of the time. So if you defrost something or put it on low power for a short time, it will either be on full power or no power. It's a pointless thing to do unless you're doing a long defrosting process. So see what happens to prove that's right. We will now start it, and hopefully it will start. No. Oh, okay, fine. I may not have got this right. Ah, nope. Doesn't want to start. Open the door for the dog and try that. No, okay. Now, power. Get that down to 50. Okay, and start. Press power again. Press time. Ah, time. Start. Okay, I'm not going to do it. I can't be bothered. It's not my microwave. but what would have happened is the light bulb would have come on, gone off, come on, gone off. And it will be on for about 10 seconds, off for about 10 seconds. A result of which is that, as I say, if you stick something in there for a short time, then you have a problem with it because it may or may not do anything sensible. Okay, one more important thing about microwaves. This balloon, air in it. Where'd the air, well, gas in it. Where'd the gas come from? Sorry? Someone gave me the right answer. The air, yeah. The air that was dissolved in the water that was in there originally. So when you heat the air up, when you heat the water up, the air comes out, but doesn't go back in. It's dissolved air. When you heat water up normally at the tap, air bubbles form, nucleate steam bubbles, and it will boil. If, however, you do something incredibly stupid and reheat previously boiled water in a microwave, i.e. put your cup of coffee back in there, your cup of tea back in there, you're dicing with death. And I'm not joking. Now, I'm not going to do the demonstration because it is far too dangerous. But I will show you a video of the demonstration. Assuming I can find where I put down my gizmo, which I've lost now, and it's in my pocket. Okay, fine. So, if you look and see what happens, if I put previously boiled water into a microwave and then take it out and add a powder to it, what happens is the water will superheat. It will get to up to 160 or more Celsius before it would start to boil. If I take it out when it's gone above 100 degrees, but not yet boiled, this is what happens. Come on, go. Out comes the water in a beaker, and in goes a spoonful of coffee. Just to show you what happens. Yeah. Now, had you put a cup of coffee in there, taken the coffee out and tipped it towards your face, what would have happened is the coffee would have boiled straight into your face. You'd have very serious burns on your face and you'd need reconstructive surgery. And it happens about 3 or 4 times a year in this country. So never reheat previously boiled liquids in a microwave. Useful bit of science to know. Again, I could go on about that, but I'm not going to. So I started talking about how science got involved with the kitchen, and I talked about one example, which was there for a long time, microwaves. Microwaves came out of the science laboratory, engineering places, and directly into domestic kitchens, and then later, much later, into restaurant kitchens. But there, this is largely because, until quite recently, messing around with food and cooking was generally regarded as not the domain of an academic scientist. It wasn't serious science. And there's one chap, Nicholas Curti. Nicholas was a professor at Oxford University for a long time. He held the world record for the lowest temperature recorded anywhere in the known universe. And then he retired back in the late 60s, early 70s, I'm not sure exactly when he retired. And he decided to try and persuade people that looking at science was a good idea in the kitchen. So here's a little clip from a program he made a while ago.
You know, it's a sad, sad reflection on our civilization that although we can, and indeed we do measure the temperature in the atmosphere of the planet Venus, we don't know how hot it is inside our souffle.
That was, until about 7 or 8 years ago, true. Now we do actually know how it is inside a souffle when it's being cooked. It's not something that's easy to measure. You might think it is, but actually, when you try and work out how to measure temperature inside a souffle without conducting heat and your temperature measuring device and get it accurate, it's really hard. However, it can be done, and it has been done. But not, unfortunately, while Nicholas was alive. He died before it happened. Now, when Nicholas was saying these things, he was a lone voice in the wilderness, to be honest. A few other people, and I was one of the ones who actually saw that programme when I was quite a lot younger than I am now, and it interested me, and it was one of the reasons why when I decided to learn to cook, I actually did it properly by doing science, not by doing cookery courses. Anyway, another young chap also saw that programme, gentleman called Heston Blumenthal, and he therefore knew that Nicholas existed. And about 20 odd years ago now, a bit less than that, he wanted to learn some science, and I'll let him explain to you about that. So this is a video which is available on the internet. It's part of the Royal Society of Chemistry website.
Let me tell you a story about salt, and one which is possibly the most defining moment in my career so far. You're always told in every chef's cookbook, every classical cookbook, that you have to have salt in your blanching water to keep your green vegetables green. Rubbish. That's complete nonsense. Right, I've said it. I've committed gastronomic heresy. Now, a few years ago, I could never understand this practice. I wanted to know why the salt kept the green colour of the vegetables. And all books said, well, they fix the colour. But for me, that wasn't enough. So I did some experiments myself, emitting the salt. I was surprised to find that the green still stayed. So I now decided that I needed to find a scientist that wanted to work with a chef. After some investigative work, I managed to contact Peter Barham, physicist at Bristol University, and we've now become friends. And Pete, do you remember that first phone call?
How could I forget? Why do I put salt in water to make up beans? Straight in there with a question, not messing around. It gets us an interesting big time since, hasn't it?
Yeah, it was bizarre because every cookbook, there's so much conflicting advice in cookbooks. Some tell you that salt raises the boiling temperature of water, some cookbooks tell you it lowers it.
It does raise the boiling temperature of water. You take a handful of salt in a pan of water and the boiling pot will rise by a minuscule amount, a fraction of 1 degree. Salt difference you get if you cooked on a hot summer's day as opposed to cooking on a cool winter's day with a different atmospheric pressure, because pressure has a big effect on boiling point, as well as adding salt.
Salt in the water definitely doesn't add seasoning, does it?
It doesn't add seasoning. The water just drops off the bean.
Nice. But if you throw your handful of salt into boiling water and then throw the beans in at the same time, the salt makes the water boil even more vigorous.
People think it changes the properties of water, because when you throw a handful of salt into boiling water, it appears to boil more rapidly. If you throw a handful of sand in the same pan, it's just nucleating bubbles in there. It's an effect of the powder going in. What's happening is the fine powder makes bubbles nucleate, so they come to the surface quickly. It's letting trapped air coming out and some steam coming out quickly. So it's simply a question of the fact we've got small particles in there.
Boys
as it falls to the water.
It's not changing the temperature of the water.
No, it's nothing to do with the fact that it's salt.
Okay, I mean, I'm not going to go into the background of why people said you add salt to water. If you really want to know, you can look it up on the internet, or you can find out that there is absolutely no reason whatsoever to put salt when you're cooking green vegetables today. And virtually no restaurants do it any longer because people like Heston have explained to them why it's utterly pointless. Okay, so I think I should move on a bit and say, well, what on earth started people like Heston talking to people like me? And the answer really comes down to scientists can sometimes answer really useful questions. And Heston started it probably largely in this country, a few other places around the world as well, where chefs actually went and actively sought out people who might be able to make their lives easier. The sort of question which was asked, this is going back a few years now, a very straightforward question, and a very important question in the kitchen in the early 2000s was, how can I do things with less labour? Because there was something called the European Working Time Directive, so you may have heard of it, which meant we couldn't work more than a fixed number of hours a week on average over a period. And that included chefs. And if you had previously, see, when in the kitchen, the chef would come in early morning, would start working right the way through and go home late at night, 6 days a week. You know, so they're working typically 100 hours, something like that, at least the junior chefs were. And so if you're trying to make a stock, which has got to be simmered and skimmed and simmered and skimmed and simmered and skimmed for something like 48 or more hours, that's not really viable because you need one person to look after it because otherwise it gets difficult. So the question is, how can I do this more simply? And that's very, very, very easy if you think about it scientifically. First of all, you're cooking it for a long time to extract flavour. Well, why not cook it at a higher temperature? If you cook it at a temperature above 100 degrees, it'll cook faster. Of course, water normally boils above 100 degrees, so you can't do that. Unless you use a simple thing called a pressure cooker, which bungs the temperature up. And then you can cook, get the flavour extracted in about half an hour, rather than 40-odd hours. And then you want to take that stock and you want to reduce it. To do that, you would normally simmer it very, very carefully, because the more heat you put into it while you're reducing it, the more you break down proteins and change the flavour and texture. So what do you use? One of these. A nice rotary evaporator, which you can stick your stock in there, leave it cooking away under vacuum, and you can evaporate your stock at maybe 70 or 80 degrees, where very little happens apart from water comes off. And anything comes off that's volatile, you can keep here, so you can put it back in your stock when you've finished. All you take away is water, nothing else. And then, okay, our stock's not very clear, what do I do next? Well, if you're in the kitchen, you do all sorts of really fancy clarification processes, which takes forever to do. Or you take your stock, you pour it into a few tubes, and you shove it in a centrifuge for 20 minutes. And that is exactly how many places now make stocks. Pressure cooker, rotary evaporator, centrifuge. It takes about 2 hours to make your stocks, which you'd previously taken you a long time. And the only cost is the capital equipment, which of course is expensive, but once you've got it, it's not as cheap to run. It's cheaper than people. So that's one example. Of course, it's not just the chefs who gain from this lark. Some scientists actually wondered what goes on in a chef's kitchen, and how do great chefs make food taste so good? I can remember when I was an undergraduate going for the first time I ever went for a decent meal out. It was actually shortly after I got engaged, and we went for a nice meal, nice place, more than I could afford. I mean, it's a bank loan job, but I was stunned because up until then I'd either had my mother's cooking, or worse, my grandmother's cooking, or my own, which was not, which was basically based on what my mother taught me. And that was when I learned that my mother actually wasn't a good cook. And I wonder how can these people take the same basic ingredients and actually make something that's completely different and actually rather nice to eat? So, you know, that's the sort of question which we scientists want to know, and it's a good question to ask. It's one I continue to ask today. So both communities, science and the restaurant of chefs cooking, messes cooks, we can all benefit from knowing a bit about the science that's going on. Okay, so just I'm going to skim quickly through a few things which we can clearly identify as having been brought to the restaurant kitchen in the last 15 years or so directly through identifiable collaborations between chefs and scientists. And I can actually trace all these back to their origins. So there are gelling agents, how to make little tiny gels, all modern gelling agents, not gelatin, other things. Things called spherification and stuff like that. And that actually was introduced in Spain by Ferran Adrià and his chefs, where he was working with a couple of large food science company, food science companies who were supplying him with and explaining him how these things worked and how he could use them. Then all the rest started in the UK. One thing you have to realise is that for most of the 20th century, the UK has had, 21st century, I mean, the UK has the best food in the world, still does. So one thing was temperature-controlled water baths and how to use them. Here's a temperature-controlled water bath, and you can control these things to, well, these days, 0.05 degrees relatively easily, 0.01 degrees, and as you will see in a few minutes' time, the temperature matters. Liquid nitrogen dry ice, which you can hardly go to a restaurant these days without doing something fancy by throwing liquid nitrogen on the floor at you in some way or the other. I remember exactly how that started in restaurants because many years ago, when Heston and I, but when Heston had hair and I didn't have grey beards, I was passing the fact that one afternoon, having been giving a school's lecture and had a jar of liquid nitrogen in the boot of my car, something you can't do today because of health and safety. But so I stopped at the Fat Duck, and we played in the afternoon with liquid nitrogen in the garden at the Fat Duck. And then about a year or so later, Heston started doing bacon and egg ice cream made at the table on his menu, which came directly from that. And then other restaurants, of course, copied and got on with it. Distillation, we've talked about distillation already. If you want to make a stock, it's a limited good way to reduce it. You can also extract fantastic flavours. If you put garlic in here and still it off, what you end up with is the most wonderful garlic flavour with none of the harshness. It's a wonderful, and it doesn't give you quite the same garlic breath the next day either, but it has all the hit of garlic. Vacuum systems. You need a vacuum system if you're going to cook sous vide. You need a vacuum system for pulling out vacuum in a vacuum distillation process. I counted up at the weekend, because I knew I was going to do this talk, how many vacuum pumps I have in my kitchen at home, and it's six. Different types for different purposes. Most of you have probably got the odd one or two without even realising they're there. But they're there. Freeze drying, it's increasingly coming in now. I know a few restaurants which are starting to use freeze drying in the restaurant. Most of it is done outside the restaurant for them, for all sorts of clever little things. Centrifuges, we talked about centrifuges, clarifying stock, all sorts of uses for one of those. Now, things which are really important, like an electric thermometer. This is something which I was horrified the first time I went to a professional kitchen to discover there was not a decent thermometer. They had a meat thermometer, which had a resolution of about 5 degrees. And that was it. A good quality electronic thermometer will revolutionise any pastry cooking immediately. I had a discussion once with a two-star Michelin kitchen. This is going back into the mid-90s, maybe earlier, actually. And I was in the kitchen talking to the chef, who was a friend of mine, and there was a pastry chef in the corner. And suddenly there was some rather embarrassing language coming from the corner and things flying around the room. The reason was that he'd just taken a large quantity of chocolate to temper and it had gone wrong. And he was livid because it takes him... I've got to go back and start all over again. It's going to take me an hour and a half to get that right. It's so difficult. And I just happened to have with me a thermometer and I said, I'll do it for you. He looked at me, you can't do that. You're not a chef. And I said, just give me a bit. So he took half and I took half. And he started doing his thing with heating it up and looking at the texture and what's written. I just took it in a water bath on a water bath, actually a pan of water with a thing on top of it, checked the temperature of the water, left it there for a few minutes till it got to about 40 odd degrees, cooled it back down to whatever the right temperature is, 23 degrees, heated it back up to 28 degrees, said, there you are, it's tempered, spread it out, and it was perfect. It took me about 10 minutes. And he was livid, but he bought a thermometer. pH meters, you need them if you're going to do gelation and other sorts of things, if you really want to play with doing, if you want to understand what your water's like, even what pH of it is. Ultrasonic mixers are great. If you've got an ultrasonic mixer, you can knock up a mayonnaise in approximately 10 seconds, rather than having to work really hard with a, do all that. You don't get so much exercise, it's one downside of it. And also, in addition to all this actual hard kit, if you want to serve good quality food, you need to understand how people taste it, how the tongue works, how the nose works, what happens physiologically. These are very important considerations if you want to make people really like your food. So all these things are now to be found in use in most restaurants that you pay more than about 30 quid for a meal. So I'm going to go quickly through three case studies because I think it's worth having a look at things which will influence what goes on in kitchens. The first one is sous vide cooking, which I'm sure you've all heard of by now, sometime or other. A lot of people don't know what it is, so I'll show you. We'll talk about taste and flavour, and we'll talk about using liquid nitrogen, because that's always fun. So let's start with sous vide cooking. Now, sous vide means under vacuum. That's all it actually means. So what you can do, though, is you can cook meat in the absence of air. Now, meat is horrendously complex stuff. I mean, it really is difficult to play with. It basically has in it all sorts of fibres, which you can end up getting as you degrade the muscle. Muscle fibres start to contract back along their lengths and go horribly tough. The temperature gets much above about 60 degrees. You end up with a tough chunk of meat, not very nice to eat. On the other hand, there's also connective tissue in there, collagen and the like, which as you heat that up, it gets softer. And basically, normally people say you've got to get above about 60 degrees to soften the collagen. That's not true, by the way. And so on. And it's really hard to work out what you should be doing. So carry on to about, if you, the other thing with meat is it's really, really, really difficult to do anything theoretical with it. I mean, as a physicist, my idea of solving a problem is to actually get a pencil and paper out and solve the problem. So the first time I was asked about meat cookery, my meat reaction was, okay, fine. Here is a piece of meat. I'm going to chuck it on a stove, and it's going to get heated from the bottom. Heat's going to be conducted into it, and it will use standard thermal diffusion rules so I can work out how long it'll take to cook. Rubbish. Meat is way too complex to do that sort of thing with it. You can't. It's just, it's got pores in there, it's got mass transport of fluids inside there, there are chemical reactions going on inside which change its texture as we cook it. It's basically almost impossible to tell what's going on inside a piece of meat. So the only thing you can do, reasonably straightforwardly, is to simply cook it so that it reaches a uniform temperature inside. To do that, you first of all seal it under vacuum. You put it under vacuum so there's no air in there. Two reasons. One, it gives you good thermal contact with the water bath it's going to go in a moment. And the other reason is bacteria, aerobic bacteria, can't grow in the absence of oxygen. So you don't have to worry about the temperature you cook it to, even if you're an environmental health officer, who don't understand these things quite often. So what you do is put it in a machine which sucks all the air out, which this is doing now. Let's put my hand on it for a moment. Right, fine. While that's sucking its air out, I'll explain what you do. You take it from there and you dunk it into a water bath at the temperature you want it to reach. Now, you can either put it in there for a fixed amount of time so you know what's going to go on and doesn't necessarily all get heated uniformly through, or you can put it in for long enough that it gets to the temperature you want it to be. The way that most people like myself and many of the professional chefs do is we know what the temperature we want is for the meat, we put it in there and leave it in there for a sufficiently large number of hours that it reaches that temperature. Once it's reached that temperature, then you will have perfectly cooked meat to that temperature. So now I've got this thing done, and I'm going to shove it. Now, this water bath is actually set to a slightly too high temperature because I haven't got a long time, but I did put another piece in earlier on, so we should have at least something to look at later. Okay, fine, time. Right, now then, let's talk about what goes on inside there. The temperature and for someone less, it's at the time that you cook something like this for, matter enormously for what happens. And I'm going to show you some photographs of lamb, same sort of lamb we're cooking in here, loin of lamb, cooked in water baths set at different temperatures for long enough that they reach that temperature. And they've been cut open. Now the top group up here are running from 57.5 up to 67.5, which is the temperature range that if you read textbooks, you're supposed to cook lamb to if you shove a thermometer into it. Okay, and as you can see, the colour changes quite dramatically over that from pinkish to brownish, greyish actually, and the texture changes even more. That's quite nice and tender. That's getting a bit tough. That's and that's Okay, so you know what sort of range you want. Now, this range, 56.5 to 58, is the range in which you'll find, if you go to a restaurant today, your lamb will be cooked to. But you can also see here that although these are all cut from the same loin and cooked at the same time in different baths, at the same different temperatures, they are different. And if you put them in your mouth, they are really different. They taste different, they have different textures and different colours. And actually, if you go to 0.1 degrees, they're still detectable one from the other. The real fun thing is, however, that if I cook at 57 degrees, three or four different pieces of meat, they all come out consistently like that one. So the temperature for a given time is a really good indicator of what you're going to get. So you have complete consistency in your product. So if you're in a chef, and by the way, this does make the most tender meat you're ever going to have, then you can use that technology to make sure you have exact consistency. You can also, and a lot of restaurants do it now, if you want a steak, they can cook the steaks. They've got four water baths, rare, medium, rare, medium, rare, medium, bit overdone, and just put the steaks in them and leave them there and then, you know, take them out when you want one so you can have it ready on the table. It's great fun. If I have a dinner party, I'll sort of, you know, usually just have two, and I'll sort of ask my guests how they'd like their steak and make sure I know, and then I'll just say, okay, fine, go upstairs, come back down with the pre-cooked steak out the water bath and give it to them. They say, how can you cook a steak in 30 seconds? I didn't. It took 4 or 5 hours, but it was in a water bath. Okay, fine. So that's one thing. Now, there's a lot more we could talk about sous vide cooking, but I'm not going to because I want to talk about taste. This is where we talk about not so much about using equipment, but using understanding. And the first thing to notice is that I've written down, as you'll see, that we have, all of us have, on our tongues at least 6 different types of taste receptor for each of the at least 6 taste sensations. Is anyone brave enough to put their hand up and say they can name all 6? I can see people getting their fingers out. Can anyone do 5? Yep, 5. Salt? Sweet? Umami? Sour, yeah? Bitter. So that's 5. Okay, fine. Those are the 5 we all know. Salt, sweet, sour. Well, a bitter, sour, and are you all familiar with those? Yep. Has anybody previously not heard of umami? Some people have not heard of umami. Okay, fine. Umami, I'm not going to tell you about all the other ones because you know what they are. Umami is, like many, like salt and sweet, a taste of a nutrient you must eat. Basically, the amino acid, which tastes strongly of umami, is one of those chemicals which controls brain function. If you don't have this chemical in your blood, and we can't make it very easily, your brain will stop working. It's quite straightforward. So you need it. It has a proper fancy name. It's called monosodium glutamate. Sometimes it's MSG. MSG, whatever you may think, is an absolute essential nutrient which you must eat more or less every day, or you will die. It's quite straightforward. And you all do. I know that because you're alive. Does anyone here think MSG is a nasty, horrible food additive that shouldn't be given to people? No one's going to admit to that now. Usually I get a few hands going up. Does anyone here think they're allergic to MSG? Nobody. That's unusual as well. I usually get a few people to say, oh yeah, I've got MSG allergy. No one's allergic to MSG, honestly. Okay, where do you get your MSG from? From, sorry? Okay, someone said Chinese food. I'm glad someone said Chinese food. Chinese food has less MSG than Western food. That's the first thing you must understand. The reason that Chinese put MSG into their food is because it doesn't occur in their food naturally, so they've developed sauces and so on which have more in, so they can be healthy. So where are the foods which are stuffed full of MSG that we eat on a regular basis? There actually are two food groups which are very rich in MSG, one much more than the other, and in each of those groups there's one spectacularly high MSG food. And they are readily available in every British supermarket. So any idea what they might be?
Marmite?
Marmite is not there. Marmite's somewhere down the bottom. Yeah, there is. Salt, but not MSG, not monosaccharides. There is some in it, not a lot. Broccoli, no. Sorry? Meat, no. Sorry? Bread, no. Potatoes, no. Seaweed is not normally, but there is plenty of seaweed, yeah, but that's not a normal in the British supermarket on every shelf. I mean, yes, you're right, you can these days. Mushrooms, no. Cheese, someone's hit the primary group. Cheese and fermented milk products, way up there somewhere. And one particular type of cheese has so much MSG in it, you can see it with the naked eye. Parmesan cheese has white flecks. Those white flecks are pure crystals of monosodium glutamate. Good for you. That's why it tastes so damn good. The second group are fruits. Fruits, particularly processed fruits, when you chomp a fruit up, enzymes will start to react, break down some of the proteins, and they will make glutamates. There's one fruit which does this spectacularly well when you chomp it up, macerate it anyway, in your mouth or previously turn it into a paste. That's called tomatoes. So if anyone asks you what umami is, it's the taste of Italian cooking. Simple. Okay, I did mention there's a sixth taste sensation, which I haven't talked about yet. Basically, you all know what it is, but you don't know it's a taste sensation because it's only in the last couple of years that the taste receptor has been identified, and that's called fat. So we now know that we can actually taste fats with our tongues. That was something that wasn't known 2 or 3 years ago. Okay, anyone seen this picture of your tongue? When I was at school, all the textbooks had this picture in that you could sweep the front and so on. There's one thing, if you see that picture, you really need to understand about it, and if it's in a school book, you see, do this to it. It's just rubbish. It's nonsense. It's one of those wonderful myths that somehow got into the scientific literature and is wrong. No one really has a tongue like that. We all have different sensitivities, so different taste sensations on different parts of our tongues. Yes, but very few of us would have that particular distribution. Now, this is important when you're thinking about food from a cook's point of view. I know because I have measured the taste distributions and sensitivity of all my family and friends. So I know exactly what my wife's tongue is like, for example, and what my own is like. It's really useful to know that because I know that when I cook something for myself and I put it in my mouth, it goes towards the front of my mouth, I'm going to get all the salty elements coming through first, because I happen to be particularly sensitive to salt near the front of my tongue. My wife is very insensitive to salt at the front of her tongue. So when she puts the same food in her mouth, she picks up the sweetness and the umaminess, not the saltiness. So she will be tasting something completely different from what I'm tasting when I've cooked for her. So you have to think about that when you're cooking, that what you are cooking and tasting is not what anyone else is going to taste, even if it's your identical twin, I'm afraid. So that's a lesson which chefs have learned, and it's really useful because it means you have to try your food out on more than just one person. Now, that's the tongue. We also perceive aroma through our noses. Now, noses are much more sensitive instruments than our tongues. We can detect thousands of different aromas. So when you're eating food, the majority of the information is coming from the smell, not from the taste. That's why if you hold your nose when you're eating your food, it tastes very bland. Or when you've got a cold, it tastes bland. If you want to demonstrate that, you can prepare a couple of purees, say a banana puree and a sweet corn puree, because they both look roughly the same colour. You can hold the nose of someone else, stuff the spoon in, and they can't tell you which is which. Let go of the nose, and they know immediately which is which. Okay, fine. That's now, also to do with aromas, you need to ask the question, why do we have a sense of smell? We have a sense of taste because we need to find things that are safe to eat and things that are not safe to eat. That's how we use our sense of taste, to find things we need, to find things that are safe. With aroma, we don't do that. We use our sense of smell to tell what is in our local environment. so we want to know whether there is something dangerous in our environment, like a cat that might, a big cat, I mean. You know, which I'm talking about, you know, the humans that are evolving, not the humans of today. So if you've got a leopard around the corner, you might not see him in the long grass, but by God, you'll smell him, because we're very sensitive to the smell of leopard and lion. If you've ever been out in Africa and you've been around, you know, you've got, that's the easy way to find one is smell it, and you'll know. So we are not really therefore caring about the absolute concentration of Roma in our neighbourhood, but what's changing? Because if you're looking at what's going in the environment, you want to know something new comes in, something goes away. So you notice change, not absolute concentration. So there's no point in keeping chucking more and more and more of a flavour into your food, because it won't make a difference. What you've got to do is make sure that one mouthful is different from the next mouthful, then it comes back again. We adapt to aromas and ignore constant smells. Now, you all know this. You really do know it, but unfortunately, you probably would rather you didn't know it, so you just don't think about it. Every time you go away on holiday for about 10 days or more, and you come back home and open your front door, your home has a different smell, which you may or may not like. But you open the windows and you put the heating on or whatever, and the smell goes away after about 20 minutes. No, it doesn't. The smell you smell when you come back after a 10-day holiday is the smell that all your friends and relatives, when they visit you, smell. It's the smell of your home. It really, really is. But you readapt to it very fast. Fine. So that's something about flavour. Now, one of the things if you're doing any work with flavour is you need to be able to describe flavour. And describing flavour is really, really hard and very important. You need to be able to communicate with chefs or whoever you're communicating with what the flavour of something is. And I want to demonstrate how hard or difficult this is by getting a few volunteers. I think I want three volunteers who enjoy drinking wines. Is there anyone here who likes drinking wine? Okay, thank you. Then you can volunteer, Louise. Yep, okay. If you'd like to come up, then yes, two. And I'd like a gentleman as well, please. I've got three glasses handy. Where's a gentleman who likes wine? Right, okay, you can come down. Right, now, what I need you to do, I have a glass of wine each. Sorry, I'm not coming down. All I want you to do is, I mean, have you been to wine tastings? Fine, so you know the drill. Basically, you smell it, you swirl it around, what you like with it. I don't care what you do with it. But all I want you to do is to give me the key descriptors, the words that come to your mind when you're tasting it. So that's the way in which flavour description works. And it's the only area of food science where it's even vaguely catalogued is in wine tasting. So, I mean, my favourite example of wine tasting on the TV is Oz Clark. Has anyone seen Oz Clark? Great, great guy. I remember him doing a wine tasting where he tasted this wine, he swirled it around, and he said, "That reminds me," he said, "of a Turkish brothel keeper's armpit." Now, I've never actually tasted that wine, but I bet if I had it, I'd recognise it. So, okay, so what sort of characteristics can you give me you think are in that wine? Sour, okay. No. Sorry? Blackberries. New green, blackberries?
Yeah,
fruit. Fruit, okay. Any other fruit? Sorry?
What? Well, I found it sweet.
Sweet, okay.
Sweet.
So this is the sort of this is a part of the way in which your tongue works is why that's happening. Different people, some people pick out sweet, some will sour, because of the way their tongues work, which is also one of the reasons why we prefer different wines. Okay. Well, we've done one wine. Let's have another one. Let's try this. No, I want you to. I want to hear your comments on this. You can keep that glass well if you like. Okay. So, again, I want you just to tell me what characteristics come across this one, so you get some other ideas. So, but you can see how difficult the people are finding it to come up with.
You have to clear the palate first.
Of course, yes. Oh, you can clear the palate.
Water.
Water. Water. Yes, water. Water.
Yes, this is strong. The red is very strong.
Okay. Okay, fine. At least you don't mind.
True.
Okay, so now, same thing, just what particular characteristics you've got for this wine?
Very sour.
Very sour. Very sour. Anything else?
Even more sour.
Okay.
Sharp.
Okay, I think I won't torture you any longer. What I will do is tell you what you're drinking, because I think you might want to know. So, the white wine is Clear Spring Sauvignon Blanc 2015 from the Western Cape, South Africa. It's actually not a particularly high quality wine from South Africa. The red wine is also South African. It's also Clear Springs. It's also Sauvignon Blanc. It's also from 2015. They are the same wine. The red one has some food colour. I am not joking. It is one of the most wonderful demonstrations of how we taste flavour. Yes. No, the dye, if you put dye in water, it doesn't taste of anything. We know that. Okay, fine. Let me explain why. The reason why is because flavour is not taste on your tongue and smell on your nose. Flavour is something you construct entirely in your brains from your memory. It is completely independent, or largely independent, of what you put in your mouth. Frighteningly enough, we can fool people they're eating or drinking things that they're not eating or drinking because we make all the other triggers work. We use every single one of our senses to build this picture of flavour. And if you're a wine taster into wines, the first thing you do when you take a wine is you compare it unconsciously, or if you're a professional wine taster, consciously, with every previous wine you've tasted. To do that, the simplest thing is say, it's red, therefore it's red wine. So I'm not going to ignore all white wine characters, so I see the blackberries, the black currants, straight away. With a white wine, you won't notice them because you're on white wines. So it's so built into us that the flavour, a red wine will taste red wine, a white wine will taste a white wine. I should carry on, sorry, but a couple few more examples of that. Not just colour. I mean, colour also affects whether you, how you like food. If you've got food served to you on a plate, then the colour of the plate will affect what it tastes like. So if, for example, you have blue plates, you'll generally find the food isn't very pleasant, because people generally don't like savoury food on a blue plate. If the plate is brown, then you've got brown food in it, no contrast, again, you won't like it very much. In general, people are different. What you are hearing affects how you eat, how your jaw moves, and how you appreciate the food. If you want to have fun one day, take your phone out, record yourself eating some crisps, and then play that recording back while eating something soft. You will find the something soft actually tastes vaguely crunchy. What you're feeling with your hands has a big effect too. A good thing you can do at home with your friends is like get something smooth, like a yogurt, straightforward, take a spoonful, give it a rating for creaminess. Make sure you don't give it 10 out of 10. Okay, fine. So rate it somewhere on a scale. Then take a second spoonful, and this time stroke something soft and smooth, you know, baby's bottom or a silk scarf, whatever you happen to have handy. And it will taste creamier, hopefully. And then if you do a third experiment where you take another spoonful and you stroke something rough, you know, your partner's beard or a bit of sandpaper, you'll find that is slightly less creamy. And, I mean, if you want to think about how obvious it is that what we're doing, all the senses actually contribute to what food tastes like is, here's a simple thought experiment you can all do right now. Think of your favourite meal. I don't care what it is, doesn't matter, just think about it. Favourite dish. And sit down at a table, nice white tablecloth, beautifully laid out, and with your best friends, sit down and start eating it. Okay, look at this happy place everyone's gone to. Now, let's take the exact same food from the exact same kitchen. But this time, we will serve it in a small plastic container with a nasty piece of plastic just stuck across the top of it. We will preheat it and put it on a small plastic tray, which we'll put on a small table folded down in front of you, with two big blokes on either side of you, and offer you a plastic knife and a plastic fork to try and eat it with. It doesn't taste any good. That's the real reason, the principal reason, apart from dryness of the atmosphere, that airline food tastes rubbish. It's far more to do with the environment you're eating and the way it's presented to you than anything else. Okay, so there's lots of other examples I could talk about, but we should move on, because we're running out of time. We cut some sous vide lamb in here, and we should now have a look at what's happened to it. Oh, so I will pull out the lamb. How long has that had? Probably long enough, just about. And I will cut it open so you can see. I'm not on that trail, right? And if I cut it open, we should be able to see now that this is nice and pink. Pretty much uniformly pink throughout, and I will just check it's okay. Yeah, that actually probably wanted a little bit longer, but it's perfectly edible. Yes, I should wash it down with some wine. Good idea. Okay. yeah, well, depends what I feel like today. Okay, so that's gone back to the sous vide lamb, but I think we should now just briefly move on to our last example, which is liquid nitrogen ice cream. Liquid nitrogen is great, useful stuff. And so I said how it got into the kitchen is largely because we started playing with it in various ways. But how do you use it really? There are lots of ways, but the original way of using it was to make ice cream. And it's always good fun. What makes really good ice cream is that the solid particles, the ice crystals, are so small that you can't detect them with your mouth. And if you make ice cream traditionally, what you do is you have a machine that scrapes the surface around and breaks the ice crystals down. And you can get them down to a size that way. So we can detect quite easily with our mouths sizes down to about 10 microns, 1/100th of a millimeter. We're very good at finding solid particles. So as you get lower and lower sized crystals, you get smoother and smoother ice cream, whatever else it may be, things being creamy. If you use a commercial ice cream making machine, or ice cream you buy in the supermarket, if you like, which has been prepared, there, because ice crystals will grow of their own accord when they're stored, they're typically about 50 microns across, the smallest ones. You just can't really store things for any length of time with smaller sizes than that. If you make ice cream in an ice cream machine and eat it pretty much straight away, you can get down to about 20 microns, maybe a bit lower. If you use some of the really, really fancy machines like Packerjets, you can get down sub 10 micron. Or you can make your ice cream so fast that the crystals don't get a chance to be any significant size at all, and you get the creamiest ice cream possible. But for that to say, you have to do it really, really fast. So I'll get some kit up here. And to give you an idea of how fast is fast, the current record for doing 1 litre of ice cream is just on 10 seconds. I'm not going to do anything ridiculously fast like that because I haven't got I need more specialised kit and I've got too much in here. But I'm just going to freeze fairly quickly this ice cream mixer sitting here. So all I do is I take my liquid nitrogen, which is just nitrogen gas, nothing dangerous at all about it. If you breathe it in, it's nitrogen. I mean, if you only breathe nitrogen, of course, you'll drown. But I mean, other than that, it's not a good idea. So pour some nitrogen in and give it a stir. It looks great, doesn't it? Because all this stuff comes to the top. That's just water vapour mostly. Some of course, is solid carbon dioxide. And as it cools, so we end up with ice cream fairly quickly. Now, because I'm making quite a lot here, I've got to give it a couple of doses. But it's getting to ice cream already, as you can see. Doesn't take much effort. And anybody who has access to liquid nitrogen, of course, can do this at home. Fortunately, I only live a 2-minute walk from my physics department, so I usually have nitrogen on tap in the kitchen, which is useful to be able to do. Not many people can do that, but it is worth being able to do it for fun. So as you leave it for a minute or two, we end up with, as I said, nice ice cream, which you can have a taste of in a little while's time when it's warmed up again, because it's a bit too cold right now. And by keeping it cold, like this for a few minutes, this will remain incredibly creamy, smooth ice cream for, well, probably about half an hour or more, by which time it will start to melt. And then, of course, we can always put some more nitrogen in and make it freeze ice cream again. So it's really good fun, and I hope you're going to eat some later on. Okay, well, I hope that I've amused you a little bit, taught you a bit of science, and that's it from me, I think. Thank you.